Hello, everybody. This is Brother Luke, Sin City Preacher. Welcome to this episode of Bible Talk with Brother Luke. Today I'm continuing the study of the book of Acts, and I'm going to pick up where I left off last time, chapter 15, verse 5. Now, if you have not seen the previous studies on the book of Acts, those videos are already uploaded and available on my YouTube channel, Sin City Preacher. I hope you will go back and watch this from the very beginning. But we're right now, I'm on chapter 15. I'm going to read the first four verses to give some context before we get started. I covered these verses in the last study, but it says, "And certain men which came down from Judea taught the brethren and said, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved. When therefore Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them, they determined that Paul and Barnabas and certain other of them should go up to Jerusalem unto the apostles and elders about this question. And being brought on their way by the church, they passed through Phenice and Samaria, declaring the conversion of the Gentiles, and they caused great joy unto all the brethren. And when they were come to Jerusalem, they were received of the church and of the apostles and elders, and they declared all things that God had done with them." So let me give some quick thoughts on the first four verses before we go to verse five. This chapter, the title of this chapter in the Amplified translation is "The Council in Jerusalem." We're approaching one of the great important events in early church history, and this has caused, it's become necessary because certain men came from Judea, maybe even right out of Jerusalem, maybe even they were men from James, as Paul refers to them in the book of Galatians. People were going to the churches that Paul was establishing and causing a big problem by telling the people that what Paul told you is wrong. You cannot simply put your faith in Jesus and be saved. More is required. You've got to be circumcised. And in addition to that, they really want them to follow all the tenets of Judaism. Paul taught that all they had to do was believe on Jesus, and now these people coming in and stirring up strife in the church, causing a division. And it says here that Paul and Barnabas had no small dissension and disputation with them. And this dispute here is really the essence of what is Christianity. Is Christianity the idea that we put our faith entirely in Christ, or is Christianity just an outgrowth of Judaism, and that a person should practice Judaism, including circumcision, following the Mosaic laws, following the dietary laws, the moral laws, all 613 laws of Judaism, worshiping in the temple, and even doing animal sacrifices. These are the things that were thought that you would continue doing these things, and now you also believe in Jesus. So the church in the book of Acts is considered to be a transitional book because it shows the transition the church went through over the first 30 years of its history, from roughly 33 AD to 63 AD. And the two big issues and questions were, first, Gentiles are not part of this. This is what they thought in the beginning. And then, of course, they were confronted with Peter being called by God to preach to Cornelius and his family, and Gentiles believed, and so now they're forced into accepting that Gentiles are also part of the church. And then the other big change is, what about practicing Judaism? Shouldn't the Gentiles be required to practice Judaism as we do? And this is the debate that they're going to have here at the Council of Jerusalem. But then not only does this practicing Judaism become an issue with the Gentile believers, but it eventually Paul in Galatians, Romans, here in Acts, in Hebrews, I think Paul wrote Hebrews, Paul draws the distinction that not only have you been taught by Jesus, Peter, John, and myself that salvation is based upon believing in Jesus, but I'm here to tell you that don't you dare add any other requirements like circumcision or any part of Judaism. You must separate yourself from Judaism, leave it behind, and entirely put your faith in Jesus instead. So this is the these are the two disputes in the early church about can Gentiles be included, and aren't we supposed to continue practicing our religion, Judaism? So with that in mind, let's continue on now into verse 5. But there rose up certain of the sect of the Pharisees, which believed. So these are Pharisees. These are the most religious of the Jewish people, the leaders of the Sanhedrin were Pharisees, and they so they're very religious Jewish leaders, and it says which believed. So they're Jews, they're Pharisees, and yet they believe in Jesus, and they say it is needful to circumcise them and to command them to keep the law of Moses. So you see, it's not only a question of circumcision, but also follow all the laws of Moses, which there are 613. All 613 were written down. 10 of them were written on stone. So it's not just the Ten Commandments, but all 613 laws, all the laws of Moses, and beginning with circumcision. These things must be practiced. These things must be done by all believers, even the Gentile believers. So now, verse 6, and the apostles and elders came together for to consider this matter. The matter was, or is it necessary to follow the Mosaic laws? You believe in Jesus. Aren't you also required to follow Judaism? Verse 7, and when there had been much disputing, so there was quite a big dispute and argument within the church over this question, Peter rose up and said unto them, men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago God made choice among us that the gospel, that God made choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. So here we have a declaration that we should learn a very important lesson from this statement here. Peter is saying that he was the apostle to the Gentiles. Now, we people consider that Paul is the apostle to the Gentiles, but was he? The first one that God directed to preach to the Gentiles was Peter. And by the way, this timeline here in chapter 15, let me look at this. Okay, chapter when Peter preached to Cornelius, that was about 10 years. Let me see. Okay, that was about 10 years after Pentecost. So the church had existed for 10 years before Gentiles were offered salvation by Peter. So, and now we go up where we are now, and that gets us to so this is, now we're roughly 20 years past Pentecost. 20 years past Pentecost, 10 years now, Gentiles have been included. And yet now, after all this time, the argument comes up, wait a second, don't these Gentiles have to be circumcised? And what about the rest of the Mosaic laws? So, that's where we are, and it might be surprising to people that so much time has passed. Now, so Peter says that God made a choice among us that the Gentiles by my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. The reason this is so important is because there are some people in Christianity here that I refer to as the Paul-onlyists. Another label that they've been given is hyper-dispensationalists, where they believe that the church didn't even start until Paul got saved. Some of them don't even believe the church was started until the end of Paul's ministry while he was in prison there. But the point is, the church did get started at Pentecost. The church or a believer is determined by the indwelling and sealing of the Holy Spirit, and that first happened at Pentecost. So 10 years later, was it Paul or was it Peter that was called to preach to the Gentiles first? It was Peter. And when we covered that portion of the scriptures in Acts, we established that Peter preached exactly the same message, not only to Cornelius, but at Pentecost and three or four occasions later, we have a record of his message, and he preached the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, the remission of sins through faith in him, salvation received by believing in Jesus. It's exactly the same message that Paul preached. And Peter was preaching it long before Paul, and Peter preached it long before Paul did to the Gentiles. So Peter is saying here that men and brethren, ye know how that a good while ago, 10 years ago, God made a choice among us. God has decided that the Gentiles, by my mouth, God decided Peter would be the one to first preach to the Gentiles. By my mouth should hear the word of the gospel and believe. Verse 8. And God, which knoweth the hearts, bear them witness, giving them the Holy Ghost, even as he did unto us. So they spoke in tongues, which was a sign and wonder that was an indication that these people believed and they were filled with the Holy Spirit. And so that was the visible sign that these people believed, and they were just the same, and just the same experience that the Jewish believers had in the beginning at Pentecost. And in verse 9, and God, he put no difference between us and them. Do you hear that, Paul-onlyists? No difference. Here, Peter is saying that there is no difference between the Gentiles and the Jewish believers. They're equally saved in the same way, purifying their hearts by faith. Verse 10. Now, therefore, why tempt ye God to put a yoke upon the neck of the disciples, which neither our fathers nor we were able to bear? What is the yoke he's referring to? The law. He's saying, why are you trying to impose Moses' laws circumcision and all the rest of Moses, the laws of Moses. Why are you trying to impose this on the Gentile believers now, or any disciples? Our fathers couldn't follow it. We would never be able to follow it. If you're going to be honest, you've got to admit you can't follow it perfectly. So this is the same message as Paul, that the law is only a schoolmaster. It's not intended to give us salvation because it's impossible to follow it perfectly. So it's a yoke. You want to impose this on them? You can't even follow it. Why are you trying to impose it on them, is what he's saying. Verse 11, but we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved even as they. I don't know how more clearly it could be stated. Peter is not preaching a different gospel than Paul here, as some claim. He's preaching the gospel of the grace of God, that God is gracious. That's why we get saved, only because he's gracious, not because of any religious works that we do. But we believe that through the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, we shall be saved by grace, even as they. So he's saying these Gentile believers, all the new believers, were saved in the same way as they are, by grace. Verse 12. Then all the multitude kept silence and gave audience to Barnabas and Paul, declaring what miracles and wonders God had wrought among the Gentiles by them. So Paul and Barnabas give an account of all the works that they had done on their ministries, all the signs and wonders, all the conversions among the Gentiles. Verse 13, and after they had held their peace, James answered, saying, men and brethren, hearken unto me. Now this James, he's considered the bishop. Historians consider James to be the bishop of the church in Jerusalem. He was the leader. Surprisingly, most people would think that Peter would be the believer. But James, the leader. So James is the leader of a church in Jerusalem. And James, in this case, is recognized as this is the brother of the Lord Jesus. Jesus had two brothers that we know of, James and Jude. Both of them became believers, even though they mocked Jesus during his ministry. After the resurrection, they are both believers now. And James, probably because they give him a great amount of respect because he was the Lord's brother. And in a way, they think that he kind of inherited the leadership position because he was the actual brother of Jesus. So James speaks, says, men and brethren, hearken unto me. Listen to me. Simeon, that's Simon Peter, hath declared how God at the first did visit the Gentiles to take out of them a people for his name. And to this agree the words of the prophets, as it is written, after this I will return and will build again the tabernacle of David, which has fallen down, and I will build again the ruins thereof, and I will set it up, that the residue of men might seek after the Lord, and all the Gentiles upon whom my name is called, saith the Lord, who doeth all these things. Verse 18, known unto God are all his works from the beginning of the world. So James is acknowledging that Simon Peter preached to the Gentiles, and he even goes to the Old Testament to talk about how this was prophesied. So on one hand, They recognized in the Old Testament that it prophesied that the Gentiles, the Messiah would come for the Gentiles too. And yet they resisted it so much. They didn't believe it at first. They had no memory of it. But now that it's happened, they recall the scriptures and are saying, yeah, this was written, and they should have known. They should have expected it. Now verse 19, wherefore my sentence is, okay, Why is James the one who's issuing the sentence? Why is he the one who's making the decision over on this matter? Because he is the bishopric, the leader of the Church of Jerusalem. Wherefore, my sentence is that we trouble not them which from among the Gentiles are turned to God, but that we write unto them that they abstain from pollutions of idols, and from fornication, and from things strangled, and from blood. So, on one hand, he's going to say that we trouble them not. But he can't just leave it alone and say, look, let's not impose anything on them. Let's not impose circumcision on them or any of the laws of Moses. And that's that. No. He decides he's got to impose something because he's a legalist. He has, and this is the first indication that we're going to find that there is going to be a conflict between James and Paul that goes on for some time. And that you find this account of this in the book of Galatians when Paul says these are men from James who are stirring up this dispute here at the churches. And I have a playlist titled Shocking Facts About James and Paul. I hope you will watch it and consider it. I also have a playlist titled Early Church History. And in the first few videos of that series, you get a historical account of all these things, this argument. And it shows clearly that James and Paul disagreed. James thought that Judaism must still be practiced by the Jewish believers. And he says, well, let's not trouble them, but we got to impose some kind of legalism on them. So he picks out a few things. He says that they tell them to abstain from pollution of idols. So no idols. And abstain from fornication, so don't be a fornicator, and from things strangled and from blood. Now, from things strangled and from blood, this is, all of these things are a part of Judaism. So they don't have to be circumcised, they don't have to follow all of Judaism, but all four of these points come from the 613 laws. These are just a few of the many, many laws. Why is it that he has to pick out these four things and tell them to that? He cannot just accept that, no, don't impose any of Moses' laws on them. Nothing. But he can't do that. That's a good question for everyone to consider. Now, verse 21, for Moses of old time hath in every city them that preached him, being read in the synagogues every Sabbath day. Let me read that, verse 21 in the Amplified. It says, for from ancient generations the writing of Moses has been preached in every city, since he is read aloud in the synagogues every Sabbath. These were Jews. They followed Judaism. They followed the laws of Moses. And it wasn't easy for them to give that up. They weren't willing to give it up. They wanted to impose it even on the Gentiles. And then Peter says, look, we haven't even been able to follow these laws. Our fathers couldn't follow laws. Why put a yoke on them that we can't even do ourselves? But instead of just accepting that and saying, hallelujah, they're free from the law, we're free from the law. But no, he's going to insist that the Jews keep following Moses' laws, and he's going to even insist that the Gentiles at least do these four things. Verse 22. Then pleased it the apostles and elders with the whole church to send chosen men of their own company to Antioch with Paul and Barnabas, namely Judas, surnamed Barsabbas, and Silas, chief men among the brethren. So I believe this Silas will be the important Silas that becomes Paul's co-worker after after Paul and Barnabas have a falling out. So Paul is his partner in the ministry is Barnabas, and later on the Silas will take that place. But so James is or the apostles, they send chosen men of their own company to Antioch. And so Antioch is where Paul and Barnabas had been working primarily for probably the last year. And they wrote letters by them after this manner: the apostles and elders and brethren send greeting unto the brethren which are of the Gentiles in Antioch and Syria and Cilicia. For as much as we have heard that certain which went out from us have troubled you with words, subverting your souls, saying, ye must be circumcised and keep the law, to whom we gave no such command. So they're saying, we never told them to go off and tell you to, you had to follow, get circumcised and follow Moses' laws. And yet he cannot just let it go completely. Verse 25, it seemed good unto us, being assembled with one accord, to send chosen men unto you with our beloved Barnabas and Paul, men that have hazarded their lives for the name of our Lord Jesus. We have sent therefore Judas and Silas, who shall also tell you the same things by mouth. For it seemed good to the Holy Ghost and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things. Why are they necessary? This is James's decree. I don't see any record of a discussion and a common agreement among all the apostles. This is James' sentence, as it says there. And he says, these are the necessary things. Abstain from meats offered to idols, and from blood, and from things strangled, and from fornication, from which ye keep, if ye keep yourselves, ye shall do well. Fare ye well. So some people think that, oh, there's harmony now. Oh, they came to an agreement, and the disagreement is settled now, but it's a long ways from settled. There's much more arguing and dissension is going to happen as we continue on. You're going to find that Paul really comes under attack later on when it's discovered that he is telling the Jewish believers not to practice Judaism. And so they really get upset, saying, okay, we conceded you that the Gentiles don't have to do much, just these four things. They don't have to be circumcised. They don't have to all follow all those laws. But Paul, he's even telling the Jews, the Jewish believers, they don't have to practice Judaism. And this, now the fight really gets ugly at that point. So there is not perfect agreement here at the Council of Jerusalem. Verse 30. So when they were dismissed, they came to Antioch, and when they had gathered the multitude together, they delivered the epistle. That's the letter from James. Verse 31. Which when they had read, they rejoiced for the consolation. They're probably real happy they didn't have to be circumcised. Verse 32. And Judas and Silas, being prophets also themselves, that's a pretty good status, that they're being recognized as prophets. Let me see how it states it in the Amplified. Judas and Silas, who were themselves prophets, divinely inspired spokesmen. That's what it says there. A prophet is a divinely inspired spokesman. So, this is... So here you have two more that are identified as prophets. No, as prophets, not apostles, but as prophets. Verse 33. And after they had tarried there a space, they were let go in peace from the brethren unto the apostles. So the representatives sent from Jerusalem, they went up to Antioch. They all shared the news about the meeting and the agreement. And then they went back to the apostles back in Jerusalem. Verse 34, notwithstanding, it pleased Silas to abide there still. So Silas stayed in Antioch with Paul and Barnabas. Verse 35, Paul also and Barnabas continued in Antioch, teaching and preaching the word of the Lord with many others also. And some days after, Paul said unto Barnabas, "Let us go again and visit our brethren in every city where we have preached the word of the Lord and see how they do." So Paul was not really a pastor. He did spend a few years, I think 3 years in Antioch or one church. Maybe it was Ephesus. I don't remember. But he did spend a few years in one location. But normally he was on the go. He was going from city to city, being a missionary, being an evangelist, being a church planter. But he wanted to make sure these churches, you know, continued in the faith properly and did not get deceived from these Judaizers, these men that were following them around. I believe that when the scripture says that Paul had a thorn in the flesh, and if you read that in context, you'll see that it's the Judaizers that were following him around wherever he went and trying to ruin his work by going, as soon as Paul preached the gospel, it's a free gift. They come and they change his message and say, no, it's not a free gift. You got to follow Judaism too. You can't be saved without doing Judaism. Just as it said in the beginning here, they were saying, you cannot be saved. The very first verse it says, except ye be circumcised after the manner of Moses, ye cannot be saved. So this continues. The Judaizers, these certain men, they continue following Paul wherever he goes and continue stirring up a strife and dissension and trying to impose all or parts of Moses' laws, Judaism, on these Gentile believers. Okay. Verse 37. And Barnabas determined to take with them John, whose surname was Mark. This is John Mark, who is the writer of the Gospel of Mark. And the Gospel of Mark is normally, it's considered to be Peter's Gospel. Mark wrote down the account as told by Peter. But this is John Mark, and Mark is with them in verse 38. But Paul thought not good to take him with them, who departed from them from Pamphylia. See, earlier, John Mark was with them, and he left. And Paul is upset that John Mark continue working with him. Maybe John Mark got tired or worn out or needed to go back and see his family or whatever the reason. He wasn't as diligent, and he couldn't persevere through all the ministerial works that Paul and Barnabas were doing. So he was disappointed in John Mark, and now it's coming back to become an issue. It says, but Paul thought not good to take him with them. Let me read that verse 38 in the Amplified. But Paul kept insisting that they should not take along with them the one who had quit and deserted them in Pamphylia and had not gone on with them to the work. So now there's a dispute. What about, should Mark be sent away, or can we let him come back into our ministry? Verse 39, and the contention was so sharp between them that they departed asunder one from another, and so Barnabas took Mark and sailed to Cyprus. So here's the division, and here's a point where Paul and Barnabas were co-workers, they were partners in ministry, and this argument about John Mark. See, Barnabas translates to son of encouragement. I forgot his actual name. It was covered in probably chapter 3 or 4, but he's given the name Barnabas because he's an encourager. And so he probably has the attitude that, but hey, let's just forgive this young man, this young believer, John Mark. He's young. He's, you know, he made a mistake, but let's not be so hard on him, Paul. But Paul, is more stern, he's more rigid, and he says, nope, he didn't stick with us. I don't want him here. He can't be part of us now. And so Barnabas and Paul end up separating, dividing over this. It's everybody divides at some point. I've experienced this so many times over the years in my Christian life, in my local ministry, in my YouTube ministry. It seems that eventually there comes a point where everybody, there's a disagreement that we just can't tolerate that. So people end up going their separate ways. And you see this happening here, even with Paul and Barnabas. Barnabas took Mark and sailed unto Cyprus, and Paul chose Silas. So now Silas will be Paul's partner. And they departed, being recommended by the brethren unto the grace of God. And he went through Syria and Cilicia, confirming the churches. All right. So that's the end of chapter 15. I'll pick up with chapter 16 next time. This is a very important chapter in the scriptures. We see this argument in the church. We see that it's brought to the apostles in Jerusalem, James being the leader. He's the one that makes the sentence or makes the decision of how to deal with it. And instead of dealing it with a complete grace, he has to have some legalism in his decision. And that's unfortunate. And that's what we see in the future here. This argument will continue about how much Judaism should be part of this. All right. Thank you for watching. I look forward to your comments. Bless you all in the name of our great Savior God, Jesus Christ.